Hello from City Hall, everyone. It is a joy to be with you, and truly a joy. I have tremendous respect for 100 Black Men as an organization that makes a real impact, a real difference, and I feel an affinity for the extraordinary work you do. Thanks to all of you for your commitment to this city and to creating a fairer, more just city. Special thanks to your president, Aldrin Ennis, for tremendous work furthering this great organization. And I am humbled. I am honored to be receiving your leadership award for the work that I've done this last year. But really, I'm going to say right back to you, it's the work we've all done. It's the work of bringing out the best in the people of New York City. What sustained me even in our toughest hours is a faith in our people, a faith in what makes New York City special, our perseverance, our compassion, our strength, our resiliency. We all know it. We see it in every neighborhood, every community. You epitomize it. This organization epitomizes it. This is a place where people gather who are serious and focused about lifting up the members of the community and helping people forward. And I thank you. I've seen time and time again the way you stood up and made a difference. And I'm asking you to do this again. We need you again, because this year, 2021, has to be the recovery year, a recovery for all of us, not a replacement of what we had in the past now brought into the future. It has to be a true change moment, a transformative moment. We have real opportunities to do things differently. I need your help convincing people how important it is to get vaccinated. We need to build trust, and getting 5 million New Yorkers vaccinated by June will open up the whole recovery. I need your help in Albany. We need to get more and more resources in the hands of MWBEs. You, as an organization, you've led the way on this issue. Let's make that threshold $1 million for MWBE contracts that we can give out with our own discretion, so we can really redistribute to people who need the opportunity. I need your help on legislation in Albany to ensure we can hire members of communities when there's new development. Community hiring opens a whole world of possibility that so far has not been allowed by state law. Let's change that. This is the year to change it. So much we need to do in 2021, and I know 100 Black Men will help lead the way for the whole city. Thank you. Thank you for all you do. Keep doing it. Thank you for all the PPE you've given out, the food you've gotten to people, the donations you've made to folks in need. It's been outstanding. Thank you, and God bless you.
Welcome to 100 Black Men of New York's 41st Annual Benefit Gala, the Day of the 100, bringing mentorship, education, health and wellness, arts and culture, and economic empowerment to our community. Please welcome the president of the founding chapter of the 100 Black Men of New York, Aldrin Ennis.
Hello, I'm Aldrin Ennis. Thank you for joining us for this virtual gala. We are so excited to have Midwin Charles. She is the founder of the law firm Midwin Charles & Associates, LLC. She provides regular commentary on law, pop culture, and politics for various television shows and networks, including CNN, HLN, MSNBC, Bloomberg TV, and TV One, and is guest host for the radio program Express Itself on New York's 107.5 WBLS. Please help me as I welcome our host, Midwin Charles.
Thank you, President Ennis and 100 Black Men. I'm honored to take part in your scholarship program. The New York Times Magazine writer Nicole Hannah Jones in the 1619 Project said, "Our founding ideals of liberty and equality were false when they were written. Black Americans fought to make them true. Without this struggle, America would have no democracy at all. We honor those that paved the way. The Greenboro sit-in, the Woolworth sit-in, March in Selma to Montgomery, Freedom Riders, Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee, Montgomery Bus Boycott, Congress of Racial Equality, Southern Christian Leadership Conference, National Association for the Advancement of Colored People, March on Washington, and the peaceful protests in spite of tear gas. Black Lives Matter." The Chief Judge of Washington, D.C. said of January 6th, What happened on that day at the U.S. Capitol is criminal activity that is destined to go down in the history books of this country, of hundreds of Americans using force and violence against their own government to disrupt what we have been the most proud of, a peaceful and democratic transition of power. We will now join moderator Michelle Miller, co-host on the Saturday edition of the CBS This Morning and national correspondent for CBS News.
Hello, everyone. I'm Michelle Miller, and I'm moderator of this activism and advocacy panel, and we have an incredible panel before you. I'd love to introduce them now. We're going to start with Wes Moore. He is the CEO of Robinhood. Latasha Brown, who is the co-founder of Black Voters Matter. She's also the founder of Saving Ourselves Coalition, a board member of the National Coalition on Black Civic Participation, the Southern Documentary Fund, the U.S. Human Rights Network, and the Congressional Progressive Caucus Center. She wanted all that to be known to the world. So Shavar Jeffries, he is a civil rights attorney and former state assistant AG. And William O. Wagstaff III, who is a civil rights attorney, member of the Mount Vernon Police Reform Commission. And we thank you all for joining us. This is a subject matter so many people are talking about right now. And it's really the issue of change and what the George Floyd moment and those of so many other Black and brown people in this day have brought to this country. I think we can all agree that there has been a shift. Just how seismic it is the question. And I present to you, and we'll start with you, Wes, just how sustainable is this change, and how specifically have you seen it?
Well, first, let me say it's an honor and a pleasure to be with you and this remarkable panel. You know, when I think about how much we have seen, we've seen a lot of movement. Right. I mean, just over this past year, we have seen a significant kick up in support of organizations that are working on racial justice and social justice. I mean, the number now hovers close to $7 billion that organizations have received over the process of the past year, which by far outstrips any number that we've seen going towards organizations. You know, we have seen protests that had went on literally daily at somewhere around the country, daily protests that went on for 9 months straight last year. So what we've seen has been a real market movement amongst folks. I think the thing that we really have to understand right now, though, is how much of it is performative, how much of it is we're doing it because it feels like it's the right thing to do. But are we actually then thinking about all the various issues in the way systemic injustice and systemic racism shows itself? Because that's, I think, one of the really important things to highlight about the things we saw for this past year. Where, you know, we did see this kind of twin crisis that was placed at our doorstep in many ways, right? We had the crisis of this virus that has had absolutely devastating and inequitable health and economic implications in our communities. We've also seen how we got the unneeded reminder of how inequitable policing is. And we watched, you know, Mr. George Floyd's name being added to a long list of names to include Michael Brown and Philando Castile and Freddie Gray and Anthony Anderson and Chris Brown and Laquan McDonald and Walter Scott and Sean Bell and Eric Gardner and Sandra Bland and Breonna Taylor and Tamir Rice and Ahmaud Arbery and Tyrone West and Trayvon Martin, and the ands go on. But I think the thing that we have to then appreciate and understand is that the inequity we're talking about, and for people to say that this has actually had a real momentum, it's not just policing inequity, right? It's not just health inequity. It's not just educational inequity. It's not just economic inequity. It's not just housing inequity. It's not just transportation inequity. It's inequity across the board. And so the thing that I think when these moments turn into movements is that, do people understand the holistic nature of the travesties that have taken place, and are we actually willing to attack it with that type of determination and with that type of focus?
Let's speak on the issue of social justice in particular, because that has been on the forefront for so long and at everyone's attention. You know, what we have seen is the states and cities are scaling back on the force that officers can use on civilians, including bans on tear gas, chokeholds, use of body cams, and transparency measures. You've seen our first police officer who has been charged and will go to trial, or at least in this one particular case of Andre Hill. When you see those measures taking place, are they really? I mean, it's not a conviction, but what a lot of people are seeing is a process taking place that people are starting to at least look at these factors. Are you know, to the two lawyers and civil rights attorneys on the panel, Shavar, William, what do you say about this? I mean, you've been involved in police reform for some time.
Yeah, the first thing I would say is when it comes to racial injustice in the policing and mass incarceration context, is the first level is we really need to decriminalize a whole host of offenses that have really been targeted toward Black and Brown folks. You know, most data shows consistently that about 80% of policing and prosecutorial resources are used for misdemeanors. And then you have a whole nother set of resources that are used for nonviolent drug offenses. We know nonviolent drug offenses, that those who have an addiction, addiction services is really a better intervention for this. Actually, it's better for the person from a humanistic standpoint. It's also economically cheaper for those who are fiscal conservatives as well, in addition to the moral claims. And we know that data shows consistently that communities use marijuana and other drugs on a proportionate basis, but it's Black and Brown people who are disproportionately targeted. So first, moving policing and prosecution away from addiction issues, away from mental health services, and allocating those resources into treatment is a big first step. Then nonetheless, even with violent offenses, we also see, even in those instances, Black and Brown folks are disproportionately targeted at every step of the criminal punishment process, from who gets interrogated in the first place, who gets stopped, who gets arrested, who gets charged, who gets prosecuted, who goes to trial, and who gets sentenced at what level. And so that's where we have to have a wide range of strategies. I would like to see governors to literally freeze prosecutions in their states whenever there's significant data showing racially disparate treatment of people in terms of how they're adjudicated by prosecutors. You have to have a much more significant intervention if we're actually going to get to a different place. We also know when we get Black and Brown people into the decision-making roles as prosecutors, that we begin to see changes. As judges, we begin to see changes. So for me, the first step is decriminalize. Police really just have too many different tools they can use to interfere in the lives of particularly Black and Brown folks. So for a lot of mundane offenses, misdemeanors, traffic offenses, nonviolent drug offenses, police shouldn't be involved in that at all. The criminal punishment process shouldn't be involved in that. That's, again, about 80% of where resources are being used now. For the other 20%, where we're talking about violent offenses or very serious property offenses, then we have to make sure we have better training, we diversify who's in the ranks, not only of our police, but our prosecutors, as well as our judges, and that we have, frankly, very forceful efforts, whether it's by governors or even the United States Justice Department, to intervene where there continues to be significant disparities in terms of how our criminal punishment process adjudicates people.
When I think about that, though, I sit back and I know that there have been efforts to reform police departments in the past. They date back some 30 years plus. So how impactful, and William, you've been, you know, a member of a police reform commission. Are we really seeing more of the same? Because we keep hearing about people being stopped unnecessarily, being arrested and tased, being killed even, you know, in the streets. I mean, is it really, what happened over the last year, is it resonating in a way that you see a difference between what has been done in the past with some, you know, for that matter, with some good efforts, depending on what cities and states you go to, and what folks are promising is gonna happen now?
I think now, more so than in the past, it has been politically expedient
to scream police reform and have these mandates. I think that it was crystal clear to any politician that was paying attention that if they didn't get on board with police reform this go around, that they were going to be on the outside looking in when it was time to get reelected. So I don't want to be cynical, but I think that right now is politically expedient. And I think that too much of police reform has been centered around training. I agree that training is important, but you can just have the best trained racist. I think that we need to start looking at the recruitment process and who we're allowing into these police forces, because once they're on the police force, they now have joined the proverbial gang, and they're going to get protections that would not be afforded to them if they were an outsider. And we need to figure out, should they actually be employed from the beginning? I was at one of our meetings for the police reform earlier this week, and we've done in the city of Mount Vernon engagement with the PBA, done engagement with the police officers and the police commissioner, because we want them at the table, because we know if you try to ram things down their throat, they're not going to be receptive. And the PBA president said, well, the civilians don't understand, and the civilians, we want the civilians to know what it's like to be an officer. And I had to kind of turn the temperature down internally before I responded and said, what you're saying is exactly what we've been saying. You guys come and you police us, you police black and brown bodies, but you don't have an appreciation for the generational trauma that we are carrying with us with each police encounter. So if you want us to do the police simulator, you want us to go through these civilian, go to the civilian academy and understand that, then are you willing to sit in on a 2-hour lesson on post-traumatic slave syndrome? Are you willing to read Ta-Nehisi Coates' books and really understand what we are bringing to every encounter with you, and that when we see you, we are seeing someone that may have wrongfully arrested a brother, wrongfully arrested a father, or done something that stripped a mother from us when she may have needed the rehab that you had no problem giving to the opiate people, the people that were using opioids? This was now a crisis, and it was mental health issues. When it was crack, it was mandatory minimums and send them away for life. So how about you start learning about our struggle, learning about who we are before you police us? And I think that's where we're going to get to something that is more long term, because the things that we're hearing now to me are the same surface level implicit bias. Train them better. We need to get 3 or 4 levels deeper, because we're trying to solve problems that are 300-400 years in the making with plans and curriculum that somebody cooked up in a classroom 6 months ago. That's not going to work.
It seems to be a vicious cycle, doesn't it? When I think about when you talk, you try to put the logic of some of the voices that we hear out there in terms of, you don't have this, does racism doesn't exist, and yet I hold it against you because of who you are, because I'm better than you. And then it goes back to the circle. But yet it's a denial of history and denial of the fact that, you know, people here have the same humanity as everybody else. Right.
But I think the reason that you have the denial is, think about fundamentally what we're asking. We're asking white society, mainstream America, to look inside and have an enlightenment that you have the things that you have, the positions that you have, the job that you have, not because you're smarter, not because you're better, but because you had the benefit of slave labor that your great-great-grandparents stole from our ancestors that gave you advantages. And for them to acknowledge that there is racism, for them to acknowledge that there is systematic racism, means they have to accept that I'm not as special as I tell myself. That cognitive dissonance that I am where I am because I'm so great, and if I accept what you're telling me, now I have to look inward, is something that most people don't want to do. And that's all people. It's very difficult to look inside of ourselves and say, I'm not as pristine and not as special as I think that I am.
Letitia, I wanted to kind of move back for a minute, because everyone who talks about 2020 talks about the fact that you had two real agendas on our plate. They weren't part of our plan, but we had the COVID-19 and the disparities that we were seeing put us in a place where I think ears were open and our hearts and minds were also open at the same time that you had these racial justice atrocities taking place. And it formed this ability for people to kind of step out and voice their horror. And at the same time, there was an election going on. And all of a sudden, people woke up. Now, you've been on the ground, and I'm dying to hear what your thoughts are in terms of our voting public, and Black and Brown voters in particular. How did people pull this off amidst everything out there that was up against them?
Because Black people are extraordinary. I do want to, just in the context of this conversation, there's an analysis that we're going to have to really shift how we're talking about public safety and how we're talking about policing in this country. We're going to really expand this conversation publicly and be honest around the system ain't broken. It's doing exactly what it was designed to do. The entire foundation of policing in this country was about the control and management of Black folks. That was the whole creation of it, that the police department actually evolved out of slave patrols. And so the whole mission was around protecting white comfort, right? At the expense of policing and managing and abusing and exploiting the labor and the bodies of Black people. And so it's on some level we're almost like expecting that at some point some altruism is going to transform and to be this something that represents and supports Black folk. I'm saying that because I think.
Yeah, I know it was that aha moment. Everybody was like, this isn't us. And I think I've been saying, no, we need to examine who us is.
That we have to take this moment and radically reimagine. And I say this all the time, in the short term, yes, we have to fight for policy. I'm a realist and pragmatic. We have to fight for policy that can actually, in the meantime, reduce the harm to our community. But I do think ultimately it is almost egregious for us to even expect that a system that was designed to control and manage the movement, the freedom of movement and the use of our own bodies and to protect white comfort, that some way we're going to be able to transform that for that to actually have a different purpose. And so in the meantime, I think what we have to do in the short term, we have to do what is needed and really being able to at least reduce the harm happening in our community, putting more people in office that actually share a vision around safety, making sure that we are having policies to hold people accountable. But I also think that there has to be a conversation around how are we radically reimagining every single system, particularly I don't want to see a law enforcement system. I actually want to, what could we design that was rooted in the notion of peace and security?
It's a freaking smorgasbord cafeteria of problems that need to be solved. Workers' rights, better pay, universal health care, educational equity, on top of social justice, on top of ensuring our political institutions remain intact. So how's he going to do it?
So let me say this. I do want to say this is probably going to be a little controversial. I really thought it was interesting that in one of the speeches, he talked about those of you who didn't vote for me. I am going to work for you as hard as those that voted for me. Where do they do that? Like, that always is an issue when it comes to Black votes. This is my point. Like, it's one thing to represent all of Americans, right? But there's also another thing about built in the fabric of this country is this need to always protect white comfort. At the end of the day, Black folks were not comfortable. I wasn't comfortable when I was riding on a bus, getting in and off a bus, like registering folks to vote, getting our people to vote in the midst of the first time I go out, I catch COVID. I and my people weren't comfortable that in the midst of actually going to polling sites, we were really threatened to be able to get arrested, that people who had registered had to re-register again. That we had literally put everything on the field and on the floor. I'm raising that because on some level, this, we've got to push everyone past this perspective of, I'm going to do the pieces that we think are for racial justice, that there has to be structural change, that every single system in this country is rooted in structural racism. And there's a values issue There's a values issue that even for me, the work that I do around democracy, my work around, it hasn't been about, democracy is not the end goal for me. Democracy is the means to an end. It is to the extent that we're using democracy to advance humanity and for the protection of my community and all of humanity. That's why I do the work. And I'm raising that because I think there has to be a conversation. We're not having that conversation. We're continuing to have conversations within the context of what I think is white comfort, about how do we maintain white comfort and white power and just get a little and get some of the pressure off of us. If we're talking about power, let's talk about power.
Even when you think about the first days of the Biden administration, I mean, like, it's nice that we can actually have a president of the United States who actually talks about racial equity and not as a punchline, right? It's nice that we have a president of the United States who, for the first time in this nation's history, actually uttered the term that we are going to end white supremacy in his inaugural address. That once you actually disaggregate the data, to say that race doesn't matter, it means that you are not in any way, shape or form being honest.
What are the three keys, and this is very quickly, the three keys to doing what Shavar just mentioned, the takeover?
It's really what Shavar said. The first thing we did is we invested in Black people. We invested in the ground. You know, what we did is we were able to move we raised and distributed over $7 million to over 700 Black-led grassroots groups on the ground, i.e. we wrote checks. In addition to that, we knew that you have to meet people where they are. And so you have to support a community in their own efforts to build power. So just as he raised, you know, while the world kind of discovered what we were doing because of Georgia race, we've been working for the last 4 years. We've helped communities win all kinds of school board seats and county commission seats, all of them. When you saw the bus, we had already been doing work there. Most folks cannot imagine America without racism, right? There is nothing, if I pick up this cell phone, if I pick up these glasses, there is nothing that has been brought into being in the physical world that was not first envisioned. And so the bottom line, if we're not gonna spend time really thinking about systems to support a world or a nation that is free of racism, we will never achieve that. And so my third part would, I do think that organizations like 100 Black Men and others, we have to also, while we're doing the work that we need to do in the short term, we also have to set some kind of framework for us to envision, right? And allow ourselves to think as Black futurists around what is the kind of nation that our people, that the world deserves, that literally will be rooted in the value and the love of humanity.
Whoa, wow. You guys are unbelievable. Black futurists, every single one of you, reimagining what this country truly can be. We're gonna have to leave it there. And I just wanna thank our panel once again, Wes Moore, Latasha Brown, Shavar Jeffries, William Wagstaff, thank you so much for sharing your time with us. And this completes our panel for 100 Black Men, Day of the 100.
As if someone else controls your every soul. I fool myself long as I can. I can feel the presence of another man. Is that when you speak my name? No, it's not the same. No, ooh, baby, I'm losing you.
Y'all heard what's happening back home. Detroit is out here raising hell because of police.
Sick and tired of being treated like niggas all day. The South ain't the only place that got rednecks.
That's our hometown, POTUS. What are we gonna do about it?
What can we do about it? It's not our place to join in.
It's our people. Our city. How it ain't our place.
It's that when you speak my name. No, it's not the same. Ooh, baby, I'm losing you.
You don't have to be an activist to make an impact on it.
There was Dr. King and the Freedom Riders and the Panthers.
We got your gigs in Chicago, D.C., Los Angeles.
Detroit was up in flames, and Newark and Memphis.
I put a division into a writer. No more playing the segregated gigs. That's progress.
But is it enough? Are we doing enough?
You might not be activists or politicians, but you're musicians, Otis. The music is colorblind.
But the world isn't.
I said it's all over your face. Someone's taking my place. Ooh, baby, I'm losing you.
100 black men serving our communities for over 50 years to produce strong young men and future leaders. And we will continue to serve, but we need your support. So help us by texting a pledge to OHBM Gala to 41444.
Hello everyone, my name is Brenton James and I am here to introduce the recipient for the Dr. Roscoe C. Brown Courage in Corporate Leadership Award. I am extremely honored to be the one presenting this award today because of how much my life was personally impacted by the leadership of Michael Bloomberg. His legacy is one that is defined by opening doors, building coalitions, and affording others the opportunity to truly make a difference. Opportunity. That is the most important takeaway that I want everyone to leave here with. Opportunity is something that many of us need, but so very few of us have access to. When Mayor Bloomberg greenlit construction of the very first Eagle Academy for young men in the Bronx, he gave opportunity. He gave me opportunity. The Eagle Academy is not just another public school system, but rather a groundbreaking network of teachers and alumni dedicated to improving the academic conditions of black men. Michael Bloomberg formed a long-standing partnership with the 100 Black Men organization, which has allowed countless students to receive the emotional and financial support that they needed to attend the colleges of their dreams, one being the University of Pennsylvania, which I attended in Philadelphia. During my sophomore and junior years of college, I interned at Bloomberg LP. I gained invaluable experiences from a company that was at the cross section of the financial markets and my passion, politics. When I was able to work there full time, I found myself in a place that trained me with the skills necessary to be able to manage and grow relationships with over 100 investment advisors from all across the country. I now know that I am on the right path to become the future corporate leader that I know I am today. As you can see, I am the result of Bloomberg's vision for education. And I know he's technically my boss, and does anyone really say anything bad about their boss? But seriously, folks, even as recently as last year, he initiated the Greenwood Initiative, which will generate black wealth and combat racial injustices. So, without further ado, I hereby present you the recipient of the Dr. Roscoe C. Brown Courage in Corporate Leadership Award, Michael Bloomberg.
Brenton, thank you very much. We're lucky to have you at Bloomberg LP. It's because of talented young leaders like you that our company's future looks very bright, and I'm honored to share this award today with you and 20,000 colleagues across the firm and around the world, because all of you really helped make it possible. As we celebrate Black History Month together, let me also acknowledge the memory of a leader I wish was still with us, my old friend, David Dinkins. And along with Dr. Roscoe Brown, he was one of the original founders of 100 Black Men. He set the city on course for an historic comeback, and everything that our team accomplished in City Hall, we did by building on his legacy. He was always very generous to me, personally, and I always appreciated that. I was especially honored that he endorsed me in my campaign for president last year, which really meant a lot. So today, I'm thinking of Mayor Dinkins, and I know he would be glad that nothing, not even a pandemic, is stopping this group from meeting and continuing its mission. Actually, one of the very first things I did as mayor-elect was to attend a 100 Black Men dinner. One of the reasons I went was to show that I was going to reach out to every community in this city, including leaders who had not been welcomed at City Hall in the past. So when I came to the event and shook Reverend Sharpton's hand, the newspapers loved it. And I don't think Al minded having his photo taken either. But all kidding aside, we've got a lot done together over the years. We've joined forces to improve education, promote public health, create jobs and affordable housing, and expand opportunity for all. And now those efforts are a big part of our work at my foundation, Bloomberg Philanthropies. As Brenton mentioned, Last year, we launched a major new effort that we call the Greenwood Initiative. I hope you've heard about it or had a chance to read about it. We named it in honor of the prosperous Black community in Tulsa, Oklahoma, known as the Black Wall Street, that was violently destroyed by a racist mob 100 years ago this year. Greenwood's destruction was whitewashed and nearly erased from American history books. But everyone should know about Greenwood, because Black history is American history, and we'll never right the wrongs of our history until we see them clearly and confront them directly. The goals of our Greenwood Initiative are to build Black wealth and advance economic justice. Last year, we invested $100 million in our country's 4 historically Black medical schools, eliminating student loan debt for 800 students. That will help ensure that none of them drop out for financial reasons. It will mean that they will have more flexibility to practice where needs are greatest. And it will mean, and all the studies show this, better health outcomes for Black patients. And that will mean longer lives and greater economic mobility for Black Americans. The team put together a short video to tell you more about the Greenwood Initiative. We'll show it now, but first, I want to thank you again for this honor. It really means a lot. And to everyone at 100 Black Men and your partners, keep up the great work. All the best. Pretty nice, huh?
Only 5% of practicing medical doctors are African American.
The data was absolutely clear on this issue. Black people have better health outcomes when they're treated by Black doctors.
Enter billionaire politician Michael Bloomberg, donating $100 million to 4 Black medical schools.
A big surprise today for students finding out that $100,000 of their school costs will be wiped out.
And now you're going to be able to change the world having less debt.
These 4 schools have trained generations of Black medical students who dedicate their careers to serving communities most in need. More Black doctors will mean more Black lives saved and fewer health problems that limit economic opportunity in Black communities.
The Greenwood Initiative is a new body of work at Bloomberg Philanthropies focused on intergenerational wealth for the Black community.
The white mob that attacked Greenwood burned 1,200 homes, looted dozens of shops, and massacred more than 200 Black residents. But those horrific numbers don't even begin to do justice to the story.
Mike's thinking about history and what systematically has been taken away from Black people, but also thinking about the future.
Some really sharp data points showed us that Black people are experiencing better health outcomes under the care of Black doctors. And there was a huge opportunity to do something about it.
This is, I feel like, why I was put on this earth, was to advance African-American communities.
Having such a generous gift would just allow every single person to serve the mission that we truly care about.
We are just overwhelmed with happiness to set the pace for future generations to come.
When I walk across the stage and I get to be a doctor and I have my white coat, and, you know, people call me Dr. Hopkins, I can't wait for that day. You're gonna be proud and you're gonna know that I'm really trying to make the world a better place.
It made sense to initiate this body of work to make a statement that first and foremost, Black lives indeed do matter.
Bloomberg Philanthropies will make a long-term commitment to this issue and continue to set a vision for what's possible in the future.
I'm Alvin Patrick, executive producer of the Race and Culture Unit at CBS News.
We have to appreciate and understand race and culture in the context of how we approach journalism. And he is the standard bearer.
He wants the whole picture included and in a way where someone can learn something about that history.
He was particularly active in opposing apartheid in South Africa.
Whose world is this?
way that I grew up was I knew that racism was there. I knew that those issues existed, but I chose not to let it get the better of me and not allow it to impede me. I believe that life is simply a series of moments. Moments to be celebrated, moments to be shared, moments to be endured, and yes, moments to be seized.
He firmly believes that education is the great equalizer and will open doors for many, and so he really pushes that.
He created a book club that went on for quite a few years, and it was pretty serious reading.
He used to always say, sports are a microcosm of life. When I was like 10 years old, I didn't know what a microcosm meant.
You can't name a book that he hasn't read. At least I haven't been able to.
Alvin Patrick has made the Race and Culture Unit something that we feel like we have needed for a long time, and I can't ever imagine living without it.
When you're honest with the people that you're covering or the issues that you're covering, the subjects tend to be honest with you. And there's nothing better than an honest portrayal of someone.
The best thing that could have happened to me was to be paired with Alvin. People want to work with folks they know care about them. That old expression, nobody cares how much you know until they know how much you care. Alvin does that superbly.
That speaks to him standing on my shoulders. But it also speaks to his shoulders getting broader so other people can stand on his.
That's what makes a difference.
Thank you, 100 Black Men of New York.
Greetings. I'm Khadim Diop, and I have just recently graduated from the City College of New York with a BFA in film production. Ralph Ellis's novel, The Invisible Man, is a metaphor for the ability to be, but not recognized or acknowledged, to exist, but not considered, to be stereotyped, but never individualized. As I work, watch, and strive to join the film industry, many often envision a life in front of the camera while not recognizing that representation at the table is a necessity to help create the full and honest narrative. Brother Patrick, we salute you for being visible, being our voice, and willing to share our amazing and diverse truth. Thank you, and congratulations.
Thank you, Kadem. One of the main reasons I do the work that I do is hopefully to inspire young men like you to chart your own path. I'm sure you will go on to do great things. Thank you to the 100 Black Men of New York for this great honor. I have won many industry awards, but this honor for leadership in journalism is very meaningful to me because it comes from an organization that is so dedicated to lifting up the Black community. And in my role as executive producer of the CBS News Race and Culture Unit, I hope that our work of reporting the truth with context, tone, and intention is uplifting to many communities of color. Of course, as a Black man, the 100 Black Men organization is special to me. You were founded in 1963, a year before I was born, by trailblazers like David Dinkins and Jackie Robinson, men who led by example. I too have tried to lead by example. My parents raised my brothers and me to first have a strong faith in God, second, to have a solid work ethic in school and at work, and third, to have pride in ourselves and treat others with respect. This is the bedrock of what I have used to achieve success in my personal life, my career, and my community. Of course, good fortune always comes into play, and my greatest blessing is my family, my wife of 32 years, Beverly, and my two children, Ariel and Andrew. They have always been my foundation, and they are the reason that I am here today. So I just want to take this moment to say thank you to them. My career has been a wonderful journey that has taken me around the world and back. But my greatest joy has always been in telling the stories of Black and brown people, from documenting the last days of Martin Luther King's life, or discovering a 14-year-old Venus Williams, to reporting on the poor children in Cité Soleil in Haiti, or documenting a summer at Rucker Park in Harlem, to profiling men of excellence like Cornel West and Ken Chenault. It has been 32 years of fun and purpose, but I have never been more proud of the commitment that CBS News has made to race and culture, especially at this moment, this inflection point in American history. Social justice, a global pandemic, and an economic meltdown have forced us all to confront our imperfect union. That's why I volunteer my time in the field of education. Over the last two decades, my work on the boards of Harbor Science and Arts Charter School in Harlem and my alma mater, Marist College in Poughkeepsie, New York, has been important because I believe education is the great equalizer, the golden ticket that can transport people from the bottom of society to the top. For nearly six decades, the 100 Black Men has been instrumental in the lives of so many young people, and that's why I'm so honored and humbled by this award. In my spare time, I collect books. My most treasured first edition volumes of African American literature date back 200 years to works by former slaves like Frederick Douglass and Booker T. Washington, free men like Alexander Crummell and W.E.B. Du Bois, geniuses like Paul Laurence Dunbar and James Baldwin, courageous leaders like Malcolm X and Martin Luther King. These men were the foundation, the legacy that the 100 Black Men has built itself upon and tied itself to by continuing its work with hundreds of thousands of husbands, fathers, brothers, uncles, sons, because you know that real progress is made by everyday people like you and me. So it is with great humility and pride that I accept this award for leadership in journalism from the 100 Black Men of New York. Because as the late, great John Lewis said, ours is not the struggle of one day or one week or one year. Ours is the struggle of a lifetime and maybe even many lifetimes. And each one of us in every generation must do our part. Thank you very much.
Where Brooklyn at? Where Brooklyn at? The 2010 census stated that New York City has the largest population of Black residents of any U.S. city. And of course, anywhere you go, if they call Brooklyn, they are always in a house. Brooklyn, specifically Bedford-Stuyvesant, is considered to have the highest concentration of Black residents. It is no wonder that some of the most influential and powerful people call Brooklyn home. Brooklyn, the home of the Dodgers, where Jackie Robinson stood strong and broke the color line. Brooklyn, home of Shirley Chisholm, first Black woman elected to the U.S. Congress and first Black candidate, male or female, for a major party's nomination for President of the United States. Without a Chisholm, they may have never been a Kamala Harris. Brooklyn, home of the first Black Attorney General in New York State, Letitia James, one of this evening's Day of the 100 honorees. 100 Black Men wishes to continue to support the scholars and their journey from Brooklyn to brilliance.
The news is one of the most powerful tools. It tells us everything from weather, entertainment, and the climate of our democracy. Jere Hester, after working for the New York Daily News as a city editor, New York Times, New York Magazine, NBC News, CNN, and others, he wanted to create his own. Jere Hester is the founding editor and the chief of the city. Jere Hester, I present to you the Leadership Through Local Journalism Award.
Thank you so much, Jonathan. And thank you to 100 Black Men of New York for the Leadership Through Local Journalism Award. This is a great honor, one that I proudly accept on behalf of our team at the city. We also try to hold ourselves to the high standards that we set for others. While we have, by some measures, a diverse staff, we're working hard to ensure that we're building a team that even better reflects the city we cover, especially for the times ahead. Our city needs our nonprofit sector, groups like 100 Black Men of New York, you know, for everything from meals to masks to mentorship. I'll take this award as reinforcement that strong local journalism will also be needed to once again make our city all it can be. At a time when local newsrooms live in danger of new cuts, and large segments of our country see journalists as the enemy of the people, this award means all the more to our team. And we're proud to be among a group of honorees dedicated to public service. On a personal note, I'm thrilled to be recognized by a group whose forefathers include Jackie Robinson, who ranks high in my pantheon of personal heroes. Not to mention David Dinkins, who gave me his time and his patience when he was Manhattan Borough President and I was a shy, scruffy kid from Brooklyn trying to become a reporter. I'll take this Leadership Through Local Journalism Award as a sign that the city is doing something right. But I'll also take it as a sign and a challenge to do even more. That, after all, is what our city demands of us. My deepest thanks again for everything, including giving me an excuse to put on a tie for the first time in nearly a year. Here's to working together to make a better future for all New Yorkers. Thank you, everybody, and good night.
This past year has proven to be the best and worst of times. We have had to overcome the fear and sadness that was brought on by this invisible enemy. But it also gave us all a moment to stop and reflect on the people, not the things that are most important. Governor Cuomo, every day you came on to remind us that you were fighting for us, and we salute you. I present to you the Crisis Leadership Award presented to Governor Andrew M. Cuomo for your proactive measures and innovative response to the COVID-19 pandemic.
Good evening, and thank you, Ms. Beaton, for that beautiful and kind introduction. The Junior 100 gives us confidence that our future is in good hands and will be able to master the many challenges they will face in this new world. A special hello and thank you to Chairman Charlie Rangel. Congressman Rangel has not only been our federal leader for many years, but he has been our steadfast champion for progressive change in social, racial, and economic justice. He has been a friend and a mentor to me, and this state owes him a great debt of gratitude. So thank you, Charlie Rangel. We are living in an historic moment. There is no doubt that it will be transformational. Our challenge is to make sure the transformation is positive and truly addresses the depth of the crisis we face. COVID created what I call low tide in America. At low tide, the water recedes and the ugliness that existed beneath the surface is exposed for all to see. Low tide in America exposed the systemic racial and economic discrimination, injustice in our healthcare system, injustice in our education system, and injustice in our justice system. Low tide made plain for all to see the extent of the health disparities that actually limit life expectancy, the disadvantage of poor communities, and how remote learning left poor and Black and brown children behind. The injustice is undeniable. COVID killed twice as many Blacks as whites. COVID infected Blacks at a higher rate, but they received COVID testing at a lower rate. We must acknowledge the ugly and gross injustice at low tide in a full-throated way, because we will never solve a problem we fail to acknowledge. And we must demand action, not just rhetoric, results. New York State will take the lead. I joined with the White House and civil rights organizations in addressing COVID inequity and in opening the largest mass vaccination sites in poor and Black communities in the country. Next, we must correct the disparities in healthcare that created more underlying medical conditions in the Black community. We must demand broadband accessibility and affordability so that education is the great equalizer that this nation has promised. And education is not a divider by wealth and race. We must reform our public safety and criminal justice system so that George Floyd and the many who came before Mr. Floyd did not die in vain. I have mandated statewide reform of every police department in this state by April 1. COVID will go down in the history books as a time of great pain and suffering. That is unavoidable. But if we seize the moment, COVID can also provoke a moment of positive change when the nation's eyes were opened to racism and discrimination that lurked beneath the surface, but is today visible and undeniable for all to see. There are no more excuses, my friends. And if not now, when? This is the moment. Progressive leaders control the federal government. As Charlie Rangel taught me, New York State is the progressive capital of the nation. Not because we just talk the talk, but because we walk the walk, because we deliver real progress and we remedy basic injustices that have been allowed to exist for too long. Working together, we can, we must, we will do it again now. We will make this state a better state, and we will make this nation a better nation for our having been here. And this is the moment to do it. Let's do it together. Thank you, and God bless you.
Over the years, we have seen a drastic shift in politics of a less male-dominated landscape. The emergence of women from Atlanta to Texas to California taking the reins of power in the political world. We also see women taking control at the anchor desk. Joy Reid's The Readout is the antithesis of this shift. Black girl excellence in action. Tonight, I am honored to present the Excellence in Political Journalism Award to Joy Reid.
Hey everyone, I just want to really thank the 100 Black Men of New York for honoring me with this gorgeous, very substantial, beautiful Excellence in Political Journalism Award. I really don't even know what to say. It's so overwhelming to just be in the same company as people like Oprah Winfrey and Muhammad Ali, my personal idol, other than my mom, Nicole Hannah Jones, who is just so amazing, and all of the past recipients of this award. It just means so much to me to be in their company, and also to be in the company of the 100 Black Men of New York, and all of the work that you're doing between the day of the 100, your service projects, all of the ways in which you're impacting our community. I am just so pleased and proud to be in family and in community with you. This has been such a difficult year, I think. 2020 has just been an unbelievable year, I think, for all of us when it comes to the suffering that we've seen in our community and in our country, whether it comes to the politics and just the fight that we've had to have just to claim our place in this democracy and the disproportional death that we've seen from COVID. It's been so painful, I think, for so many people, and so difficult and such a challenge that just to see the recognition that I'm getting from you all, just for trying to do my share, my little tiny, tiny share of trying to do my part to tell our stories, it just means the world to me. So I just wanna thank you all. I wanna thank you for everything that you all are doing, and I hope that I will continue to make you proud. So thank you all very much, and I hope that your gala, for the rest of your gala, is gonna be amazing.
When I say money, power, respect is the key to life, I think Tulsa, Oklahoma, the Greenwood District, also known as Black Wall Street. I think Harlem, New York, entrepreneur Sarah Walker, also known as Madam C.J. Walker. When I think of empowering the next generation and the rebirth of Greenwood, I think of education and economic opportunity and the role that banking will play. Let's join our panel discussion on economic empowerment and banking.
Thank you everybody for joining us. We are here today to talk about economic empowerment and banking. You know, we know that Black small business owners and entrepreneurs have made tremendous strides in closing the racial wealth gap. They're the first group, though, to suffer when economic downturns occur, like we have been experiencing throughout the past year in this pandemic. Black Americans, though, have more resources to lay the foundation for wealth building today than previous generations. And we're here to talk about the resources that are available, some that you may not have even realized. With us are an esteemed group of panelists that are here to share their expertise and their journey with you, starting with John Rogers, who is chairman and CEO and chief investment officer of Ariel Investments. We also have Michael Pugh, who is president and CEO of Carver Bancorp, and Kiko Davis, who is with First Independent Bank, a trustee, managing director of Grooveville Productions and Publishing as well. And I thank you very much, Kiko Davis-Snoddy and Michael Pugh and John Rogers, for being here and joining us for this discussion. I want to kick it off with you, John, to talk a little bit about setting the stage of where we all are right now and what you have seen over the past 12 months or so as some of the biggest obstacles, but challenges that have been overcome in terms of economic empowerment, banking, and wealth building. John?
Well, thanks so much, Sharon. You know, I'm not quite as optimistic, I guess, as some of my teammates and colleagues are. As you know, here in Chicago, for example, we have lost all of our large Black businesses. You know, 40 years ago, we had Johnson Publishing with Ebony and Jet. We had Johnson Products with Afro Sheen and Ultra Sheen. Burrell Advertising was huge. Independence Bank was the largest Black bank in the country. Seaway was one of the top five. We had large insurance companies. You could go on and on. They're all gone. We basically have gotten much smaller. When you look at the Crain's list of top 300 privately held companies, there's only three African Americans out of that top 300, 1%, and not one Black company makes the top 150. And this is before the pandemic hit our community. So it's really quite challenging for Black entrepreneurs here in Chicago, and I'm assuming it's very similar around the nation. The last other data points, Midwin Charles, who's the dean of Yale's business school, has this data that says, relative to white Americans, we're worse off today than our grandparents were. You know, sort of a dramatic shift when it comes to wealth building in our society. So I'm hopeful that things will get better because of what happened with George Floyd's assassination and people getting more thoughtful around these issues, and some white organizations really are starting to be more progressive and have a conscience. But that's a hopeful thing that's happened in the most recent several months. But otherwise, we've been feeling quite depressed about our community, especially here in Chicago.
Michael, what about in New York, where Carver Bank is located? And what have you seen there? Have you seen the same type of shrinking? And are you as concerned about the situation right now in terms of the banking world, in terms of entrepreneurs in the New York area?
Sure. So I would certainly concur with John's comments. You know, I remain less optimistic about the opportunity for wealth building within communities of color, particularly African-American community. And one of the most important points there, I think, that supports that is that there are studies that are showing more than 41% of Black-owned businesses have been negatively impacted by the pandemic and have either closed their doors or at risk of closing their doors. So when you consider that fact alone, what it suggests is that the wealth gap is continuing to exist between the Black community and certainly other races, other communities that are here in our country. I think what we're seeing is that as the Small Business Administration certainly talks about small businesses being those businesses 500 or less employees, many businesses that are 75 or less employees will continue to be significantly impacted.
Yeah. Kiko, are you as pessimistic about the outlook? I know in talking to you previously, you are the queen of reinvention and of teaching people how best to do that. Where do you see the state of businesses and entrepreneurship right now in the Black community? And what is your bank doing in terms in this environment?
Well, I agree with both of the panelists that it is very challenging and we have some rough road ahead. However, I think that we have to go back to financial literacy and coming up with solutions that can actively be put into action. Just because things are difficult and challenging does not mean that it is impossible to overcome or to at least attempt to be optimistic in the future ahead. And I think there's many steps to building wealth, and you just have to begin somewhere. And many times I hear from individuals that I don't know where to begin, it's too complicated, or my parents didn't teach me. It's a matter of changing your mindset. Your parents didn't teach you, or there's a US Bank study that shows that 56% of parents of 18 to 24 year olds had little to no involvement in the family's personal finance. No wonder when we go out into the world, we don't have an understanding of money or how business works. So my parents didn't teach me and their parents didn't teach them. But as individuals, you have to break that cycle and educate yourself, begin coming up with a plan and a strategy for how you're going to change that cycle. And once you do that, you can put those into steps that you can begin building wealth, because we have to change the mindset, such as teaching our children about personal finance, investing in our children's education, taking advantage of life insurance, building a business that you can pass down, and some of the more advanced strategies such as investing in real estate or the stock market. But you have to break the cycle. We have to begin somewhere, and you have to start.
John, you were talking about Johnson Publishing earlier and some iconic Black businesses in the Chicago area with a national presence, but headquartered in Chicago, that are no longer in existence. And this is prior to the pandemic when some of these issues were occurring. With businesses, Black businesses of that scale, what are some of the issues that have created this kind of demise of some of the key institutions that we've had?
I think there's a couple of things, or several things, of course. But one of them is this term supplier diversity that's become so, so everyone just talks about it all the time in the National Supplier Development Council. And as we all know, most city governments and universities and hospitals, they work with Black businesses. They work with us construction, catering, janitorial services. Those are the typical supply chain opportunities. So as our economy has become more of a professional services, financial services, technology-based, media-based society, we're left out of the part of the economy where the wealth and jobs are created today. So these well-meaning programs, we're not interested in advertising in Ebony or Jet. You know, that wasn't something that was on the agenda because people had been sort of brainwashed that we wanted to do the construction, the catering, not these other parts of the spin where really the power and wealth is created today. And that shows up that so many times as we've gotten into leadership roles in corporate America, you know, at ELC or we're sitting on corporate boards, we sit in these boardrooms and these leadership roles and allow the spending to continue to go to white companies where people have their own agenda, they have their own relationships. And as Reverend Jackson says, you know, it's not that people are always intentionally racist, they're just not thinking about us. They're going to give the contracts and the opportunities to people that they're familiar with, who they grew up with, and the like. And the third thing I would say, and this is really important, a generation ago, we had Harold Washington in Chicago. We had Maynard Jackson, my personal hero, in Atlanta. We had Coleman Young in Detroit, which you know you guys know that are from Detroit. We had these guys who understood that if we were going to bring wealth to our communities, we had to build a strong Black entrepreneurial community. And that was important, and get more Black leaders in the large corporations. You know, Maynard Jackson insisted all the banks in Atlanta have Black board members for the first time, or they wouldn't be able to do business in Atlanta. This generation of leaders, not that these other issues aren't important, but they're not focused on building Black businesses. You're more likely to see new politicians talking about climate change, which is important. And they'll be talking about all the other types of things that are sort of the sexy issues of today, not about building, again, a strong Black business community. Now, there's some hopeful leaders out there. You know, of course, Maxine Waters continues to do yeoman's work, now as chairman of the House Financial Services Committee. The new Congressional Black Caucus chairman, Joyce Beatty, is absolutely fantastic on these issues. But they're few and far between of our political leaders that are leading with the importance of building, again, a strong Black business community and strong Black leaders throughout our major cities.
I'm wondering, Kiko, how can people who have a business that could fit into what a major corporation may need, how do you make yourself known to the right people?
Well, in the business community at large, one of the greatest tools we have is networking. And so when people say they don't know the right people or they're not in the right situation to take advantage of those relationships, you have to go out and make yourself available. So it takes some effort on your part, but it's not impossible. And I think that having a mentor, you can find mentors in many different professional organizations, especially now that the country is so focused on racial equity.
And John, let me ask you the question that I know you get asked all the time, and I get asked all the time. So I want to be able to say, well, John Rogers says you should do it this way. How do you get started investing? What is the first thing you should do? Because people are looking at some of these stocks that I would have never imagined an 18-year-old in my house would want GameStop, but he asked me about it. And I'm like, that's not where you begin, but maybe you'd say something differently. So where do you start when you want to invest?
Well, I think first and foremost, you need to get yourself educated about the markets. But the second thing is read. And the greatest book ever on investing is a book called A Random Walk Down Wall Street by Burt Malkiel. And one of the things that's great, and not only tells you the basics of how to invest, but he also talks about these great bubbles in history and how people get swept up in the kind of emotion and how inevitably those kind of manias always end badly for those that jump in the on the bandwagon too late. The best way to create wealth is to invest over the long term in great businesses or great mutual funds.
It's excellent advice from each one of you in terms of reining in your spending and understand what you're spending on, building your relationship with your bank, and making sure that you read as much as you can before you're investing this money for the long term. Know how it works, how investing works, and where your money is going to go and how it can grow. So I thank each of you for being here for this really informative panel discussion. Kiko Davis-Snoddy from First Investment Bank, as well as Michael Pugh from Carver Bank, as well as John Rogers from Ariel Investments. Thank you all for your time.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Take care. I'm Sharon Epperson with CNBC. See you guys next time.
Queens, where the Prince of Zamunda went to get his bride. It's not only the backdrop for the iconic Coming to America, but was the place that the Honorable David Norman Dinkins forever left his mark. But let's start with the founding of 100 Black Men. The one came from activism of Robert Mangum, standing up for a young woman who was arrested unnecessarily. This mobilized a group of powerful Black men to bind together and seek justice and equality. David Dinkins was amongst that band of brothers. He later became the first African-American mayor for the city of New York. The Honorable David Dinkins made a large impact on the lives of New Yorkers, New York children, and then the world. David Dinkins signed a 99-year lease, creating the U.S. Open that brings more economic benefit to the city than the New York Yankees, New York Mets, New York Knicks, and New York Rangers combined. The city's revenue-producing events, Fashion Week, Restaurant Week, and Broadway on Broadway were all created under Dinkins. The Honorable David N. Dinkins is our king, and New York is your queen-to-be.
We are living in an exciting time that we are becoming more politically and civically engaged than ever before. It is no wonder that when Ritchie Torres states on his Twitter handle that he is a product of public housing, fighting for people whose struggles were his own. That is how he was elected to office. People want to know that they're not only understood, but that the fight is not rhetoric. Ritchie Torres, we salute you with the Honorable David N. Dinkins Political Trailblazer Award.
Congressman Ritchie Torres. And I'm honored to accept the David Dinkins Political Trailblazer Award from 100 Black Men of New York. Thank you, Junior 100 Alan Baines, for presenting the award and inspiring all of us with your dedication. All Black elected officials stand on the shoulders of giants. When it comes to New York City politics, the greatest of those giants was David Dinkins, who, as the first Black mayor, blazed a trail for generations of Black leadership in America's largest city. More than a trailblazer, David Dinkins was New York City's greatest statesman, who stood above the fray of petty politics and who set the highest standard of integrity and dignity in public office. The unprecedented times we live in require more public leaders with the moral core of David Dinkins. In the 245-year history of the United States, there have only been about 163 Black members of Congress. I never thought in my wildest dreams I would be one of them. I was born, bred, and battle-tested in the Bronx. I spent almost all my life in poverty. I was raised by a single mother who had to raise three children on minimum wage, which in the 1990s was a mere $4.25 an hour. I grew up in NYCHA housing, living in conditions of mold and mildew, leaks and lead, without consistent heat and hot water in the bitter cold of winter. I never imagined, as a poor kid of color, embarking on a journey that would take me from public housing in the Bronx to the People's House in Washington, D.C. I am proud to be honored by 100 Black Men, which demonstrated a fearless commitment to public service in the most terrifying moments of the pandemic. From providing PPE to our essential workers, to supplying hot meals to our families in need, to giving grants to small businesses struggling to survive. When others stood on the sidelines, 100 Black Men rose to a once in a century challenge of public service during a pandemic. Thank you for inspiring us with your public service on the front lines. And thank you for honoring the legacy of David Dinkins, not only with your words, but with your work.
Hello, my name is Nathaniel Samuel, and I'm currently a senior at Hoboken Charter School. I am also part of the Junior 100 program. And the Junior 100 program allowed me to connect with others and also help my community.
It is an honor to present the Judge Robert Mangum Excellence in Public Service Award to Letitia James. Never has an award felt so tailor-made. This Brooklynite took her Howard University education and Brooklyn smarts to be public defender, New York City councilperson, New York City public advocate, to then become the first woman of African-American descent to be elected to citywide office. We salute Letitia Ann James.
Good evening, and thank you for that warm introduction, President Innes. It is an honor to be with this esteemed organization today as you celebrate the Day of the 100 and to join you in this call to action and service to our communities. For decades, the 100 Black Men has served as a beacon of hope, an opportunity for our young Black men. In sharp contrast to the ways we have otherwise been shut out and put down and demeaned and portrayed. This year in particular, we pay tribute to the fierce resilience and perseverance demonstrated by our Black brothers and sisters in the face of the challenges we were presented. As we well know, this past year was not just rocked by a public health crisis. We also saw racial injustice rear its ugly head from the depths of our society. Accountability and transparency must take precedent over abuse that power and silence breeds. And this wonderful organization has done just that each and every time. And it is for those reasons I am honored to be the recipient of the Judge Robert Mangum Excellence in Public Service Award. And though he came from humble beginnings, the Honorable Judge Mangum formed a life of service, progress, and great accomplishment. From his tireless work to rebalance the scales of justice, to his leadership in creating and advancing this organization, he was a true visionary. I am deeply humbled by this recognition in his name and from an organization that deeply values public service, community, and the advancement of Black boys into successful Black men. In line with the theme for this year, the call to service is key to fostering compassion in our local communities, the ripple effects that carry on from the little things we do every day don't just transform our cities and towns, but also our nations and the world at large. Thank you again for this award, and thank you for bestowing upon me this honor. And I look forward to witnessing the very bright future that continues to lie in the wings of your organization.
New York, the city so nice, they named it twice. Manhattan is like no other. Bright lights, the music, the energy. It's the city that never quits. Against adversity, we continue to strive. Dr. James McCune Smith was born into slavery in 1813 in New York City and was set free on July 4, 1827. At age 14 by the Emancipation Act of New York, he is credited as the first formally trained African-American medical doctor and was one of the Committee of 13 who organized in 1850. In New York City, to resist the newly passed Fugitive Slave Law by aiding refugee slaves through the Underground Railroad. And then fast forward to Adam Clayton Powell Jr., the first African-American descendant elected to New York to go to Congress. And then Barack Obama, the first Black president of the United States and the White House, which was built by slaves. We are the light shining on the hill. We are the brightest of the city. 100 Black Men of New York is dedicated to helping our youth shine bright like a diamond. You can do your part by using our text-to-pledge feature and text OHBMGALA to 41444. Thank you.
Hi, everyone. This is Senator Chuck Schumer, and I want to thank 100 Black Men of New York for the chance to share a brief message during your 41st annual Benefit Gala. To Executive Director Courtney Bennett, to President Aldrin Ennis, and to all of 100 Black Men's leadership, thank you, thank you, thank you all for keeping this important event going, even in these strange and difficult times. Of course, to all of our great honorees today, let me recognize you now. To Governor Cuomo, Michael Bloomberg, Attorney General Letitia James, Representative Ritchie Torres, Joy Ann Reid, Jere Hester, Alvin Patrick, and Valerie White, congratulations. Thank you all for working so tirelessly to advance the cause of justice, of fairness, and of economic opportunity for African Americans across New York and around the country. We have a lot of work to do in 2021 and beyond to rebuild this nation. As Majority Leader, the first to serve New York, I will make it my mission to work with you to open the doors of opportunity for communities of color and make sure that our national recovery brings all Americans along, not just those at the very top. And in the weeks and months and years ahead, we'll work together on legislation to root out systemic injustices that we still face as a nation, including in our systems of justice, in our economy, and in the voting booth. This will be our mission in 2021 and beyond, and I'm honored to work with all of you to make it happen. So thank you, thank you, thank you to our honorees, to this great organization. My best to you on a successful year.
Indivisible, written in 2016 by Leah Greenberg and Ezra Levin, was the call that fueled many to action. But getting and galvanizing Americans has been the work of civil rights activists, whether just sitting in a seat at a counter, on a bus, not riding a bus, or walking across a bridge. The fight was not to maintain this American democracy, but for America to truly have equality. Historian Dr. Jelani Cobb wrote in the New Yorker article, Stacey Abrams' Fight for a Fair Vote, that the Democrat Stacey Abrams has become the nation's most prominent critic of voter suppression. After the 2020 presidential election, Dr. Cobb tweeted, quote, "If Georgia puts Biden-Harris over the top, the administration and everyone who voted for it is indebted to Stacey Abrams," unquote. Stacey's work in Georgia started a decade ago and was realized this January. This work has to continue so that we don't have to be so black and blue. We now join Bakari Sellers.
Good evening, this is Bakari Sellers. I am a CNN political commentator. I am a husband and father. I'm an author of the New York Times bestselling book, My Vanishing Country. And I'm here with you all today at the 41st Gala, where we're celebrating the great work of the 100 Black Men. And this fireside chat, I have the privilege of joining me, United States Congressman Jamal Bowman from the 16th Congressional District in the great state of New York. Did I get that right, Congressman? I want to make sure.
Yes, sir. Absolutely right. How you doing, sir?
Man, I'm more blessed than I deserve. And today we're going to be talking about civic engagement over the next 4 years. We've had a pandemic reminiscent of 1918, 1919. We've had volatility in the market reminiscent of 1928, 29. And we've had this racial reckoning reminiscent of 1968. All in 1 year. So what are some of the greatest challenges that are facing our people, Black and brown individuals, when it comes to maneuvering through this convergence of historical issues or moments at one time?
And I would add, we've had Donald Trump for 4 years as well in a recent insurrection on the Capitol. So we're going through a lot. We're going through a collective trauma that we've been going through for quite some time, but it's obviously much more fresh now because of recent events. You know, the disproportionate number of people in our community catching COVID, being hospitalized by COVID, and dying from COVID. So one thing we have to do is we have to continue to work together, because unfortunately, you know, our elected officials, and beginning with the federal government, continues to not center our community and our needs and put us at the top of the agenda, even though we've been the most vulnerable for far too long. So we really have to look out for each other. Secondly, we have to demand accountability from our elected officials, and we have to organize ourselves to do so. You know, we're hearing a lot more conversation about racial justice and economic justice and social justice and racial equity. I mean, Joe Biden, President Biden, spoke about racial equity in a way that I had not heard a president speak about before. But it can't just be words, it has to be actions. And the only way those actions are going to transpire is if we organize and hold them accountable.
I look at COVID in two buckets, one being public health, and one being economic. And so let's address that public health aspect first. What do we have to do to ensure access to vaccinations? On top of the fact, what do we have to do to deal with the very honest conversations we have to have about vaccine hesitancy due to the distrust and implicit biases we've seen in our healthcare delivery system over a period of time?
Yeah, I'll start with the second question. One of the reasons why I was very public with my fear and anxieties around getting the vaccine, because, you know, our history, the Black community's history with healthcare in this country and the mistrust and the experimentation is well documented, from the Tuskegee experiment to medical apartheid, to so many other examples. We do not trust the healthcare system, and rightly so. So I was very public and very transparent with my fears and my anxieties as I went to get the vaccine. But I encourage others to do so, because this thing is killing us at a disproportionate rate, and it connects directly to the public health aspect of your question. We are disproportionately living with comorbidities, and these comorbidities exist and persist because of political neglect and government neglect. So we mentioned food insecurity earlier, but housing insecurity, underfunded schools, lack of green spaces, environmental racism, trauma from institutional racism, these all contribute to comorbidities that leave us more vulnerable to something like COVID or other upper respiratory illnesses. We disproportionately have asthma, we disproportionately have diabetes, high blood pressure, et cetera. So when we talk about public health, we talk about a holistic approach. Right. And when we talk about defunding the police, we're talking about reallocating resources towards true public health. Invest in food security, invest in housing security, invest in fully funded our schools, invest in green spaces so that our kids could go outside and play in healthy environments, invest in mental health support so we could deal with the stress and trauma that is also killing us as well. So it's a holistic approach to public health so that we can live as our best selves within our community. But that only happens through organizing, consistent pressure, supporting each other.
I'm glad that you also talk about, and one of the things we have to begin to talk about is public health as a holistic approach, because when you grow up and you are, you know, you're living a food desert, you're drinking unclean water, inhaling unclean air, don't have access to a hospital with quality care, then it's no wonder you have these comorbidities, and you overlay it with the pandemic. So let's talk about the economic impact on our communities. We all know, you and I know, and everyone watching knows, that the fastest growing small businesses in the United States of America are Black women-owned small businesses. We also know that COVID has reached and reaped the most devastation on Black and Brown and Native American businesses. We also know that the PPP loan program didn't get to these same businesses. They were being ravaged by them. So when we talk about the economic aspect of COVID and the devastation going forward, how do we make sure that we have some level of not equality, but equity, ensuring that these Black businesses can survive, can thrive, and that people have an opportunity to continue what they started prior to last year?
Great question. And just so you know, I believe we should fight for both equity and equality, because equality is our God-given human right, and we need to fight for that as well. So right now we have a stimulus package that's moving through the House and the Senate at $1.9 trillion. We're going to be using the reconciliation process to make sure that stimulus package passes. So if you are working in the manufacturing or advanced manufacturing space as a small business of color, if you're a small business that provides services to your community, that's going to be the time to get engaged, get involved. Again, I hate to be a broken record, but if our voices aren't heard through organizing and pressure, you know, the policies that we need for our communities will not be built, not be put in the bill in the way they need to be put in. So it's going to take organizing, it's going to take pressure both from the House, the Senate, and the White House. And these two stimulus packages are key to getting it done in a very fast way. Going forward, we have to continue to support, in my opinion, investment in Black and minority women-owned businesses through capital from our federal government, through incentivizing private organizations to get more involved in our communities, but also, and this is something we're going to have a hearing on this week, through a real conversation about reparations. You know, we continue to be victims of policies that are discriminatory and that marginalize us and oppress us. True reparations in the form of cash payments, in the form of investing in small businesses, in the form of higher ed, in the form of fully investing in our schools and the like, is something we need to push for as well. But it's only going to be together. It's only going to be through organizing.
I want to get to that organizing point because that is a very important point in a second. I want to talk briefly about what we saw last summer and with the protests, the very righteous protests that were, most people don't know this, but a lot of these protests were majority white attended, et cetera. We begin to see communities come together, I think, as you talk about. Yeah. Often, should we expect this to sustain? What's your outlook on the future? I never thought that I would be sitting around quoting Ronald Reagan, but I do quote him in this instance when you say trust but verify. Tell me what your thoughts are after seeing last summer where Black Lives Matter approval rating skyrocketed to its highest level. You even had Mitt Romney saying Black Lives Matter on Black Lives Matter Plaza. Mm-hmm. And just where we sit as a country in your perch looking forward?
I do expect it to sustain because people have had enough. As you mentioned, this was a diverse coalition of people protesting across the country, and people are sick and tired of it. You know, the convergence of the pandemic, the economic, oppression, and the murder of George Floyd, which we all saw, the entire country saw it at the same time, I think is what has this racial reckoning and a diverse group of people rising up against injustice in all its forms. So I expect it to continue. We have to continue to ensure that we have to work to ensure that it continues as a community.
I've always told people that there are a few components to criminal justice reform from a federal level that we have to see, which is a standardized use of force that we teach across the country, a database for misconduct and misconduct by officers, narrowing or limiting qualified immunity, banning chokeholds, et cetera. Are we ever going to get to the George Floyd Justice and Policing Act or the BREATHE Act or some variation of it? Can we actually reap the policy benefits of our efforts last summer?
Yes, we can. I agree 100% with the four points that you just brought up. The main way for us to get there is for the Congressional Black Caucus to exercise its power. The Congressional Black Caucus can leverage our numbers to make sure certain bills are brought to the floor for a vote and voted on and passed the House. So from a House perspective, we can absolutely do it, and we need to apply the requisite leverage in the Senate to make sure we pass the George Floyd Justice and Policing Act. But this is our time to be bold, man. This is our time to be visionary. This is our 21st century FDR moment, but this time we're not going to leave Black people out.
So you're talking about having an FDR moment. This is something that is required to get to that portion, especially doing, as you're talking about criminal justice. And Joe Biden is further along than anybody else on this issue, but he's not where we are yet. And how do we push to get this where it needs to be, especially to help our people?
And it's not just Joe Biden. It is Joe Biden, but it's the House and the Senate as well. And this is an issue where there's some agreement amongst Democrats and Republicans, and there's some agreement amongst people in urban communities and rural communities as well. There's a lot of division around a lot of areas. This isn't one of them. So, you know, again, political pressure, leveraging and organizing gets people to respond in a way that they may have not responded before. And the people demanding that this issue becomes a central part of the Biden agenda and of a congressional agenda is going to be key. And the other thing I want to say is, you know, Republicans may take back one of the three branches of government, one of the three in terms of House, Senate, and White House in 2022. So we need to push and organize and work to do as much as we can between now and then, so that we can, you know, push the proper policies forward. So, you know, let's not think in 4 years, let's think in a year now. You know, this is 2021. You know, what can we do over the next year? And we can do a lot. You know, as an educator and now as a member of Congress, I always understood my role as a Black man is not just being an educator or a congressperson, is one of a father figure and one of a role model. So, you know, the best thing for me to hear, and I've heard it many times since, you know, we were fortunate enough to win, you know, I've heard from young men, you know, I'm only at this meeting because you're here, Mr. Bowman. I only got involved in organizing because of your campaign. And I've heard that from young men time and time again. So we all have a responsibility because of this, particularly because of this country's history of racial oppression, to uplift other young men of color, young women of color, Black people. It's our job to uplift them, and mentoring can take so many different forms. It could be a once a month check-in, once a week check-in. It could be via Zoom, via text, via a call. But whatever we have, man, it's our job to share with the world. And by sharing with the world, we build a better world. And, you know, I take that part of my job probably more seriously than the other parts.
Well, I'm from the big city of Denmark. I know you're from the big city of New York. We got a lot in common. But in Denmark, we got 3 stoplights and a blinking light. And my mom and dad always tell me the 2 most important words in the English language are the words thank you. And they're not nearly said enough. And so it's time for us to wrap up this portion of the roundtable discussion, fireside chat. As you hear my twins in the background saying that it's time to cut. But I just want to say thank you for all of everything that you have done. And even more importantly, everything that you will do. You are a hero to many, and you're doing God's work. So thank you and God bless you. God bless the 100 Black men. God bless everything that they're doing. And we will now get back to your currently scheduled programming and show.
Let me salute the 100 Black men of New York on your 41st annual gala. Fortunately, as a result of the pandemic, we're unable to gather in person as we would normally do. But thankfully, we're gathered together virtually. To mark this occasion, and to celebrate this extraordinary organization, 100 Black Men of New York. These are challenging times for the African-American community, for New York City, and for the nation. But our own journey as African-Americans and as African-American men shows us that we have the resilience and the strength and the ability to take and deal with the adversity that we are compelled to confront at this moment, and to keep moving forward. A knockdown is different than a knockout, and a setback is nothing more than a setup for a comeback. And I know that 100 Black men of New York have the resiliency, the capacity, and the ability to weather this pandemic storm, to help us all get up off the ground as a community, and to keep moving forward, to build back better, and to continue our long, necessary, and majestic march toward a more perfect union. God bless you. God bless 100 Black Men of New York. And God bless the United States of America.
At one time, books were the keys to education. Now, education is powered by 5G. When a child is struggling, we ask, did they have the tools? This last year revealed how quickly our youth could fall behind and what fair education really looks like. It's not our children. Betsy DeVos showed the system is not passing the test. F. Let's join our panel discussion on education equity.
It can't beat education and mentoring. And many of these youngsters who come along, if they just had somebody to whom they could talk.
Hello, everyone. My name is Medina Torre. I'm the New York City education reporter at Politico, and I'm very excited to be moderating this forum today. We're going to be talking about a very, very important subject, and that's educational equity. As you all know, the coronavirus pandemic has gravely exposed the educational inequities in ways that are previously unseen. And of course, Black and Brown children have been affected by it the most. The inequities that they have experienced include outdated learning strategies and lack of access to technology, amongst other issues. We have a very exciting lineup of speakers today who play a key role in shaping educational policies, and I'm very excited to introduce them all to you. We have Dr. Lester Young Jr., who's the Chancellor of the Board of Regents. We have David C. Banks, who's the President and CEO of the Eagle Academy Foundation. We have Gabrielle Wyatt, who's the founder of the Highland Project and partner at the City Fund. And we have Richard Carranza, who's the Chancellor of the New York City Department of Education. I'm very excited to speak with each and every one of them, and I hope you enjoy the conversation. First, I wanted to start by asking all of you, what lessons have schools and community stakeholders learned during the coronavirus pandemic that will chart the course of a new and equitable learning as well as accountability models?
I think the primary lesson is that the inequities, the historic underinvestment and non-investment in some of the most historically under-resourced communities that we talked about in a historical sense, this pandemic has laid bare that those are exactly the same communities that have been disproportionately impacted by this pandemic. So what it means for us and the lessons that we've learned is that the post-COVID-19 normal cannot not and should not, and we cannot allow it to look like the pre-COVID-19 normal.
If we want to see equity at the core, it starts with listening to Black mothers. I think we all saw the New York Times article this week featuring Miss Sarah Carpenter in Memphis, where she spoke about the decades of mistrust against public institutions, against public education, and the real lived experiences of figuring out what does it mean to put her kids back in school, a school system that she knows is one that contributes actively to the school to prison pipeline, a school system that may represent years of underinvestment in school buildings. We have to get underneath the source of mistrust right now with Black moms and Black caregivers. And beyond getting beneath that source of mistrust, we have to ask them, what does recovery need to look like?
President Biden has talked about opening schools within his first 100 days. I sure hope somebody's going to give New York City a call, because while it hasn't been perfect, we've been open since September 21st with very safe schools.
I think educators across America are very, very hopeful now that President Biden has been elected. He has selected as his Secretary of Education a gentleman who has been a school leader, a principal, a superintendent, one who seems to, his reputation is one who seems to be as a good listener and somebody who understands the issues of the day. That, I think, has caused all of us to be very hopeful. Over the past 4 years, our Secretary of Education has been someone who I believe is not only tone deaf, but was never prepared to lean in into public education in a way that really manifests the kinds of changes that have been necessary. So it remains to be seen how things will play out, but I'm very hopeful on the education front. The president is married to a woman who's a lifelong educator. She gets it. And so every signal that we have heard suggests that there's gonna be a real turning point for us in the education space, and we're gonna have the folks in place in Washington, D.C., who I think will set us on the right course for success.
We have to be very deliberate around addressing their unique needs. And what do I mean by that? You know, we've become very good at analyzing data, or I should say conducting racial analysis of data. And all of us have become, you know, quite adept at being able to identify what youngsters can't do based on who they are. We have not been very good at providing solutions that are targeted at the very young people that we've identified as being deficient in a variety of areas. And so what we're proposing is that we have to begin to target the investments to ensure that the most in need, the most vulnerable, the ones who've been impacted the most during this particular period, receive the investments and resources that they need. The other thing that I think is critical, and we're probably going to need help from our new administration on this, is that we have to re-examine the way in which we fund education all across the country.
The amount of loss that has occurred as a result of virtual learning, or the lack thereof in far too many cases, is almost incalculable. We our children are suffering tremendously and have been suffering throughout this pandemic across New York City and, in fact, all across the country. I think our teachers have done the best that they could under some very difficult and trying circumstances. But this pandemic has just really placed an undue burden on our families, all of our young people. The first time I've heard young people almost just giving up on themselves. For so many of them, the light has almost gone out. There's a level of trauma that they have experienced that I don't think most adults are fully appreciate just how significant this loss has been. When you couple that with the fact that for far too many of our young people, they were suffering before the pandemic. Our school system was still not meeting the needs of far too many Black and Brown children pre-pandemic. And so as we begin to think about emerging from the pandemic, we've got to really look at not only what the COVID comeback plan is, but how we fully reimagine how we do school in the first place.
I have one final question. I'll just squeeze in here, so I know we're out of time. I wanted to get a sense of what you think can be done to incorporate Black history and the Black experience in school curricula. I know we're in the middle of Black Lives Matter at Schools Week. One of the things that they're calling for is mandating Black history and ethnic studies, among other demands. And I know that there were a lot of protests nationwide in response to, you know, the deaths of Breonna Taylor and George Floyd. So I was wondering if you could talk about that a little bit. And, you know, Black history, but also generally speaking, like the whole issue of culturally responsive curriculum and having minorities, people of color reflected in school curricula. How, and I guess the question for Chancellor Kranz and for Dr. Young is like how what steps are being taken to address that issue that's been coming up a lot.
I've been very, very, I hope, plain spoken about the fact that the curriculum does not look like the majority of the students that we serve. Over 81% of the students in the New York City public schools are children of color. They're Asian, they're Black, they're Latino. So when they read about history, when they read stories from authors, when they interact with in science, do they know that their ancestors, that people that look like them, that may have grown up like them, that may have spoken a language similar to what they speak or their grandparents speak, actually had an influence in what we are now as America? And if the answer is no, then it is insufficient for the children that we're educating, because the system belongs to all of us. That should be happening 12 months a year. And the way you make it happen 12 months a year is that you have curriculum, you have materials, you have books, and you have an implicit knowledge that that's important.
But another area that I think is critical to this is how we prepare our teachers. Because, you know, often people think, well, if we just have a curriculum, you know, if we just have the books, then that's enough. Well, that's not enough if the people who are using the curriculum, who are using those books, don't believe in the value of the young people in front of them.
We're in Black History Month. We have a couple more months left of the school year. From my perspective, I think about my father, who was a social studies teacher back in Baltimore, and his perspective was, let's reveal history by omission. And in that, what I believe he meant was, as we all know, Black history didn't start with slavery. And our experience isn't just about police brutality. Our history begins in Africa, and our experiences reflect pioneering new solutions and social change. Our experiences reflect viewing the world with abundance, despite the fact there are many injustices that we face. And so my ask of educators in the months ahead is that we amplify not just the voices of those we stand upon, Rosa Parks, Martin Luther King, but we amplify the voices right now in our communities who are embarking on real change.
Thank you to all of our esteemed panelists for joining me today to discuss the very important issue of educational equity in the coronavirus pandemic. We all learned so much about the challenges that students are facing, especially students of color. I hope that everyone listening today enjoyed the conversation as much as I did. Till next time.
100 Black Men was formed by a group of professional men, doctors, lawyers, and others.
Motivation was an incident where a black woman was stopped by the police and unfairly treated,
resulting in her arrest. And Bob Mangum heard about it.
And our first president, Bob Mangum, who's with the police department, canceled her citation, and he caught some heat for that. And we felt we had to defend him and the other blacks who were in public life.
Since we were few, I always moved on the premise that you had to be unified as much as possible in order to attain something significant dealing with the power structure.
We had a meeting in his apartment on Riverside Drive, a handful of us.
He indicated that he was trying to organize a group of men to try to deal in an organized way with the problems.
There were many of us who had some positions of authority or influence, and we didn't even know each other.
A group of like-minded business, political, and community leaders met to discuss the conditions and how to improve them.
It came out of a desire and a need for black people, black men in this instance, to work together to see that we are treated fairly.
Thank you all very much. I often say that because we're here in New York City, I'm not infrequently in the company of African diplomats and those from South Africa have a custom. Instead of acknowledging all you important people by name, they simply say usual protocols observed. So, usual protocols observed.
Good evening. My name is Courtney Bennett. I am honored to serve as the executive director of the 100 Black Men of New York, the large chapter of the year of the 100 Black Men of America. Thank you for attending our 41st annual Benefit Gala on this, the day of the 100. With over 50 years of service, the 100 has touched hundreds of thousands of New Yorkers from every borough, including Staten Island, which brings the Verrazano Bridge, the Staten Island Ferry, Wu-Tang Clan, and 4SMDs to mind when many think of it. As a graduate of Wagner College, I fondly remember my days on that island. Most important to 100 Black men, Staten Island is the home of one of six Eagle Academies. In 1995, members of the 100 attended the Million Man March, returning with a strengthened resolve to close the achievement gap and disrupt the school-to-prison pipeline that was keeping so many of our boys from attaining the educational and career success essential to living successful lives, leading stable families, building strong communities, and breaking the cycle of poverty. Inspired, OHBM presidents Luther Gatling and Paul Williams led the effort to start the first all-boys school in New York in 30 years. With the support and influence of fellow members, including Reverend Jacques DeGraff, Ben Thompson, Tyrone McKinney, Rudy Coombs, and David Banks, who would become the founding principal, the first Eagle Academy was born in 2004. Today, we are continuing our commitment to mentor, coach, and develop tomorrow's leaders through our Junior 100 mentoring program, which offers caring mentors, character development, financial literacy and leadership training to 750 New York City middle and high school students. Please visit ohbm.org to learn about the Junior 100 and all of our community service initiatives. But for now, sit back, relax, and enjoy the day of the 100. Oh, and don't forget to text OHBM GALA to 41444 to make a pledge to support our work.
What is a Maverick? John Lewis, Shirley Chisholm, Spike Lee, Reginald Lewis, and new Vice President Kamala Harris. By definition, it is someone who is unorthodox. When you have neighborhoods and people who are underserved, who are in need of someone to level the playing field in housing, health equity, and the workforce, we need someone who will make demands and has the courage to stand behind them. Valerie White is that Maverick for our community, and we salute her with the Economic Development Maverick Award.
Generational businesses that have been the anchor of our communities, now we're fighting to hang on to their livelihoods while struggling for survival. More than 85% of our Black-owned businesses have been forced to contemplate permanent closure. At LISC New York City, our mission aligns with the core values of 100 Black Men. We stand on a platform of racial and economic equity, investing capital and technical resources in underinvested, underrepresented communities to move toward closing racial gaps. The gaps of access, the gaps of wealth, the gaps of ownership. All these exist between Blacks and whites in our country. Commercial corridors and the small businesses that fill them are the economic foundation of the Black community, providing jobs, preserving culture, representing stability, offering wealth generation. Amid the pandemic, LISC NYC launched our New York City Small Business Relief and Recovery Program. We distributed more than $3 million in direct grant relief to nearly 300 small and minority businesses across the five boroughs. Through our program, we work with local community partners who are on the ground in the neighborhoods, providing a long-term and customized technical assistance to local businesses. Our mission is to promote holistic, sustainable solutions to help Black business owners that have historically lacked access to funds and position them to keep contributing to New York City's economy. We are proud to share the vision of 100 Black Men. For decades, I have had the pleasure of working with former President Michael Garner and many of the 100 Black Men members to demand equal access to opportunities for Black businesses. The growth of our Black economy directly depends on ownership, opportunity, and community support. But we cannot let the distractions of 2020 and 2021, growing infection rates, unspeakable racial justice, continued systemic racism, thwart our hopes. We stand in the shadow of founding member David Dinkins, former mayor, who so proudly fought for inclusion and the gorgeous mosaic of New York City that he so loved and helped nurture and grow.
We would like to go to Vice President Robert Brown for closing remarks. Mr. Vice President.
Thank you, Midwin Charles. I hope you're enjoying the day of the 100. My name is Rob Brown, Vice President and Chief Financial Officer of the New York Yankees, Chairman of the 2021 Day of the 100 Gala Committee, and first Vice President of the founding chapter of 100 Black Men of New York. We could not get together to share hugs and handshakes as we usually do. However, by joining us virtually, your support for our organization and the people and communities we serve has never been more strongly felt.
We'd like to thank Bloomberg Philanthropies, News Corp, One World Trade Center, whose sphere will be lit tonight in honor of the 100 Black Men.
Uber, United Airlines, thank you for moving our students from home to campus. Wilkie Farr, CBS News, JP Morgan Chase, Charter Communications, Emblem Health, Fairview Capital, Health First, List New York City, Madison Square Garden, Bombas, the Eagle Academy Foundation, Howell Industries, Inbooz, Mutual of America, Turner Construction, and the New York Yankees. Thank you for opening up Yankee Stadium for COVID-19 vaccinations. I've received mine. I hope you will receive yours when it's time.
Your financial support will help 100 Black men develop tomorrow's leaders through mentoring and college scholarships. With the help of all of today's contributions, we will continue to feed hungry New Yorkers and support small businesses. That's great news. If you like what you saw today, please tell a friend and ask them to text OHBMGALA to 41444. That's OHBMGALA to 41444 to support the work of this worthy organization. On behalf of our president, Aldrin Ennis, our board of directors, and all of our members, I'd like to thank you for joining. By the way, I'm from the Bronx, and I know a good DJ when I hear one. DJ Envy of the Breakfast Club is the real deal. So sit back and enjoy the Day of the 100's after party.
And that's our show for tonight. Thanks for joining us for a wonderful evening of inspiration, aspiration, and motivation. Please don't forget to take a moment to donate by texting OHBM Gala to 41444. Now, DJ Envy, let's do this.